मिस्टर श्री राम सिंह चौधरी यू नॉट ऑडिबल मिस्टर श्री राम There's a lot of noise.
Am I audible here now?
Yes, sir.
Oh, is it audible now?
Very clear.
Oh, very good. Okay. With the Vinod, can we start?
Yes, Mr. Sriram, we can, please.
Okay. Okay. So, very good morning to all of you who have joined this session. On behalf of Southern India Chamber of Commerce, I extend a hearty welcome to one and all. I am Sriram Balakrishnan, Chairman GST Task Force, Southern India Chambers, and I will be conducting the proceedings of this session. I would like to request all of you to put on mute unless you are speaking. Firstly, I would like to thank the President of Southern India Chamber of Commerce, for consenting to do this program on e-invoicing today at a critical juncture when in less than 2 weeks, the rollout of e-invoicing is to commence in the country. I would like to thank also Mr. J.M. Kennedy, if he has joined and he has agreed to join, Commissioner North Commissionerate, Chennai, in agreeing to grace the occasion and provide his perspective, and Mr. Prakash Kumar, CEO GSTN, and other officials, including Mr. Butt from NIC, both from GSTN and NIC, for agreeing to participate and do the presentation on e-invoicing, followed by Q&A session. Now I would like to request Mr. Arun, the President of the Southern India Chamber of Commerce, to kindly do his welcome address. Over to you, Mr. Arun.
Thank you, Mr. Sriram. Am I audible to all?
Yes, please.
Mr. Prakash Kumar, the Chief Executive Officer of the GSTN, Mr. J.M. Kennedy, ARS, Commissioner, not Commissioner, Mr. B. Sriram, partner, Ernst & Young, as well as important members of our GST now. Special invitees to today's program, ladies and gentlemen. A very good morning to each of you. I'm glad that we have the presence of each of you for a very important discussion. Mr. Prakash Kumar, I'm glad that we are touching during one of the initial programs on GST, when GST first came about, and we shared the stage together. Glad to have you with us. Ladies and gentlemen, the Goods and Services Act was introduced with effect from the 1st of July 2020. It was a reform in the tax regime since our independence. The policy aimed to streamline the taxation structure in our country by doing away with multiple taxes and cesses levied by the various state and central governments. By introducing a unified tax system, which has in turn assumed nearly all erstwhile Indian tax laws. Despite operating issues, GST has, as expected, is gradually stabilizing over the larger Indian economy. The GST Council has gradually started making new and appropriate changes in the GST regime, and thankfully also listening to all stakeholders in time, and also correcting procedural related aspects. The GST Council has been very responsive to the requirements of the industry as well as trade from time to time, and has suspended cumbersome compliance requirements on the part of taxpayers. The GST Council, with a view to curb anti-evasion measures, has decided to implement the e-invoicing, in which B2B invoices are authenticated electronically by GSTN on their common portal called Invoice Registration Portal, or IR for short, which is in turn managed by the GSTN itself. E-invoicing is slated to be effective from the 1st of October, as Mr. Sriram had also mentioned, for all taxpayers having turnover of over 500 crore rupees. Further, SEZ units have been excluded from this compliance requirement. With the introduction of e-invoicing, will reap the benefits of faster availability of genuine income tax credits, indirect tax credits, sorry, ITC, real-time tracking of invoices, so automation of tax return filing process, and lesser possibility of audit surveys, tax authorities. Information is available on implementation of e-invoices to benefit in the system and changes suggested for tax. In intention behind
Mr. Arun, just 1 minute. May I request all the participants to kindly mute your microphone? There's too much of background noise. We are not able to hear Mr. Arun.
Yeah.
Mute. And the host, I will request the host to kindly mute everyone.
Yes. Yes, please. I have muted everyone. Mr. Arun, you can unmute.
Mr. Arun, you're on mute.
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yes, yes.
The main intention behind today's session is to throw light on the concept and changes that have been taking, as well as to throw light on the transition from the current system of issuing invoices to the new e-invoicing mechanism. Recently, GSTN was described by Mr. Nandan Nilekani as India's most radical support for India's tax reform. Mr. Prakash Kumar, the CEO of GSTN, we are very glad that he has chosen to invest his time with us to help us understand the updations in the new system. We welcome Mr. Prakash Kumar and his team to this interactive session. I welcome Mr. John Kennedy, IRS Commissioner GST, who readily accepted our request and has agreed to join us. I welcome all members who have connected through our online platform, and I wish you a wonderful learning experience today. Thank you.
Can I now request Mr. J.M. Kennedy, Commissioner, to do his inaugural address, please, and carry your thoughts on e-invoicing.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Sriram. Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, please.
Because we are not, very much used to video conference, but now, of course, due to COVID, we are getting used to. Southern India Chamber is one of the, very old chambers in Chennai, beginning in the year 1909, and we are almost now past 100 years. And it's doing a wonderful work in making bridges between the policy and the industry, so business and industry. Here, President of the South India Chamber is here, Mr. R.M. Arun. Good morning, sir, and I welcome all the participants today, particularly Prakash Kumar, sir, is here, CEO of GSTN 1975 batch IAS officer, he is here. And under his leadership, GSTN is doing a wonderful work. They are doing, they are breaking all shackles and obstacles, and they are constantly marching towards excellence. That is something which is really heartening, glad, and we should all celebrate and appreciate that. Take, for example, India is simply too big and huge. Many of us, we do not recognize, or we don't claim like that. See, take, for example, 1.26 crore GST registrants. As on date, you have 51 crore returns have been filed so far. 138 crore e-way bills have been generated from the system. About 15 crore total payment transactions have been in the GST network. And if you see, highest number of payment transactions in a day is about 24 lakh. So 24 lakh people could file return on a day, and around 10 lakh payment transactions were done in a day. So it is GSTN is very huge infrastructure backbone, and they have been marching towards excellence one after another. Now coming to the theme of the day, it is the next big step we are taking in ease of doing business. It's a very big step we are taking. Around 120 countries in the world have adopted e-invoice already. Around another 60 countries, they are contemplating. Of course, they are in various stages, and there are a lot of debates going on, intellectual debates. Around 120 countries have accepted e-invoicing as something very important for a GST system. So India will be one of them to get into e-invoicing starting from the 1st of October. So very big historic step for us in ease of doing business. I mean, primarily if we see the e-invoicing right now is restricted to businesses with more than 500 crore turnover in a financial year. So we are talking about big businesses which are having more than 500 crore turnover. And not only that, those who are only having B2B supplies, we are looking at P2B transactions where the e-invoicing is going to apply, not to B2C, only to B2B transactions. Even among the companies which are having more than 500 crore turnover, in all B2B transactions, your invoices will be e-invoice. And very importantly, if you see the e-invoice is not generation of invoice from the portal. You are generating invoice as you do normally. As you do every day, you do an invoice. Only thing is the invoice particulars are transmitted to the portal, the invoice portal. Roughly around a dozen portals have been created for the purpose. And GSTN have been continuously doing testing of these portals since January. And they are upgrading, resolving technical glitches. And they have been doing a wonderful work since January. And it was also in the public domain that you can do a testing of your own. You can upload some invoices and see that started in January for 500 crore turnover, then 100 crore turnover. It was brought sometime in February. So consistently, the theme is in the public domain. So in 2019, September, GST Council proposed this idea of e-invoicing. But from there, we have developed a lot. And GSTN has been consistently working on that. Even now, you see in the web, they have created a number of videos. In fact, their videos are available in the YouTube channels. So you can watch them, and they have published very elaborate FAQs. So FAQ is covering every aspect of the e-invoicing. So e-invoicing, as I said, is a wonderful way of creating ease of doing business in the country. So this is a big step which we are taking. And as I said, it is only for B2B invoices right in the beginning. And what are the three things which you are going to get when you transmit your normal invoice data? As you do normally, you generate invoice every day. But when you transmit it using a JSON file of certain fields, you are going back and you are going to get IRN, which is the most important thing. That is the invoice reference number you are going to get, the IRN. The IRN plus QR code you are going to get. And this QR code is the most important aspect of the e-invoicing. The QR code is having around 8 parameters. So simply using the app, if you read the QR code, it will give you 8 parameters. And one of the 8 parameters is the IRN number itself. That is the invoice reference number. So every invoice is going to have an IRN. That is the most important part of the e-invoicing. So the system gives you the returns in the JSON file, it signs with the digital signature and it is giving you QR code and the IRN. Now, the most important part, why this is called as ease of doing business is that it avoids, first of all, multiple entries. So how many places you type the invoice number? So hereafter, you simply read the QR code, the invoice details are there. So you don't have to type your invoice numbers every time. Supposing that you do every time, there are a number of errors. Transcription errors keep coming. So now these transcription errors can be avoided in the e-invoicing. So once you have done it, Once the invoice details are transmitted to the portal, and from the portal, an IRN is generated with QR code and the digital signature, and the system automatically, the portal returns you that, again using the JSON file, then it is easy for you that you need not do multiple entries. Even e-way bills can get generated automatically. Again, you do not type the invoice number or particulars for it. The QR code simply you can read and the details are populated. And it is very easy for you. You can compare with your purchase orders at the end of the day or at the end of the month, because you have already transmitted the invoice numbers. So this is one of the very important steps which we are taking for ease of doing business. And such a wonderful medium is coming into effect from October 1st. Around a dozen portals have been already created and tested by the GSTN. And Mr. Prakash Kumar, CEO GSTN, is with us today. And is for at this time when hardly around 10 days are left, this time is very precious for them. And at this time, he has been willing, and he has taken time to join with all of us, particularly through the South India Chamber. So that is something which is remarkable. I thank Prakash Kumar sir, CEO GSTN, for coming for this video conference with his team. And he's going to explain to us the various features of the new e-invoicing system. And I'm sure they're going to go in depth. And on our side also, I think the business and industry should take initiative. A welter of material is available in the public domain. FAQs are available. They have made beautiful videos. I request every one of you to please familiarize yourself so that we can make the e-invoicing successful. That is very, very important. And I'm sure the members of the South India Chamber always have stood at the front, forefront in making the government policy successful. I'm sure you will be able to do that. And it is ease of doing business. It is in your own interest, so that we'll be able to do our best. And we are going to make e-invoicing successful. Thank you. And over to Prakash Kumar, sir, for making his team for making the presentation. And at the end, there will be a question answer session, so that everybody can pose your questions and take clarifications. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy. Really succinctly, you have put the advantages of the e-invoicing system, and you have very beautifully explained how the two key important networks, GSTN and NIC, have successfully implemented the GST in the country and also the e-way bill system in the country. Before I hand over the proceedings to Mr. Prakash Kumar, I would like to, for a matter of 5-10 minutes, talk about few aspects, legal aspects relating to e-invoicing, and also talk about how businesses are preparing for e-invoicing, and a few open issues which any of you have shared with Mr. Prakash Kumar and others, which will be taken up at the end of the session. But before that, I would like to briefly touch upon few aspects. So I just wanted to say that e-invoicing, of course, is going to be effective from 1st October 2020 in the country. And it is applicable, as Mr. Kennedy said, to start with companies having 500 crore and above turnover, and only with regard to the supplies made in the course of B2B transactions. With the introduction of e-invoicing, businesses shall enjoy a system-driven input tax credit determination on a near real-time basis, and a real-time tracking of invoices through automation of tax return filing process, and of course, thereby bringing down the compliance burden of the taxpayers, as the information is captured at the transaction level. So while it is expected to result in a huge advantage to both the revenue as well as to the taxpayer, of course, there are few areas as a starting point which requires furthermore clarification, both from the legal and the systems point of view. I would quickly touch upon them. Today, as a legal background to GST invoicing, we have few sections and rules in the CGST law. Section 31 talks about GST invoice, read with rule 46, 47, and 48. And there are other provisions for issuing bill of supplies in the case of exempt as well as B2C supplies. So we are, e-invoicing is more concerned with the provisions relating to GST invoicing rather than the provisions relating to bill of supplies, to start with at least, because bill of supplies talks about both the exempt and the B2C transactions as well. Rule 46 lays down the contents of the GST invoice. Today, the GST invoice for the last 2.5 years, which the businesses have been using, contains about 22 field data fields. And this is a standard which has been laid out in GST law today. Going forward, for eligible taxpayers crossing the 500 crore threshold limit, as well as conducting the B2B transactions, other than the excluded categories, namely the SEZ units, the taxable service providers of GTA, Goods Transport Agency, banks, NBFCs, insurance companies, passenger transportation services issuing tickets to the passengers, and multiplexes providing admission and exhibition services of cinematograph film. These 4-5 categories are excluded. Barring these 4-5 categories, others are covered if they are providing B2B transactions for raising the e-invoicing and obtaining IRN number from the IRP portal. So if any GST invoice is issued post 1st October 2020 without an IRN, that GST invoice is an invalid invoice. The aforesaid requirements are being brought as an amendment to Rule 48.4, Rule 48.5, read with Rule 54.2, 3.4, and 4A of CGST rules. Even today, there are few areas on the coverage which requires clarification, sir. Namely, we have said 500 crore pertaining to the financial year, as is mentioned in notification number 13/2020, dated 21st March 2020. Financial year 19-20, or is it any of the last of the three financial years starting from 17-18, is something which needs a clarification. Of course, one of the FAQ did mention that any of the three financial years, if a business has exited, then they can opt voluntarily to get into e-invoicing system. It is not very clear whether it is mandatory or whether it is voluntary, and which financial year 500 crore threshold needs to be tested. Assuming in the last three financial year 500 crore is not there, and in the current year they may exceed 500 crore, at what point in time such businesses have to get into e-invoicing is also required to be clarified. As e-invoicing requirements are brought in Rule 48 pertaining to manner of issue of invoice, applicability of e-invoicing requirement for credit note and debit note, which are governed in Rule 53, which is yet to be amended from a legal perspective. Of course, we all know that e-invoicing is applicable to invoice, debit note, and credit note. But from a legal point of view, this is something which I'm sure will be fixed in the coming days. On the excluded categories, again, there has been a re-examination FAQ saying that the excluded categories is applicable entity-wise rather than... Can you? I'll put people on mute. So on the excluded categories, while there are few clarifications are required, the recent FAQ clarifies the exclusion for the entity as a whole and not for the specified business activity or the GST registration. On this basis, the businesses are preparing on the implementation front. Lastly, on the time limit for raising the e-invoice, it has been stated that currently there are no time limit. And this is the understanding with which businesses are preparing for implementation of e-invoice. With less than 2 weeks to go, any further changes to the above understanding would make it practically difficult or delay the preparation by the businesses to comply with e-invoicing from 1st October. A typical preparation in any organization, sir, would involve changes to ERP systems and changes to several business processes, besides revisiting the customer and vendor contract terms and providing appropriate training to the users. For business to understand about e-invoicing, they need to not only understand the legal provisions, but also the schema, which is the GST Invoice 01, as well as the latest version of API, version 1.03 issued on 5th of August and subsequent enhancements. There are about 52 validation checks which are also required to be addressed. So even for organizations which have a robust ERPs and businesses processes, the above activities will take not less than 3 to 4 weeks for preparations. From Southern India Chamber's point of view, we have also separately given few questions and suggestions which may be considered by the GST officials for deliberation at the end of the session. With this backdrop, sir, I would like to hand over the proceedings to Mr. Prakash Kumar, CEO GSTN, and the team from GSTN as well as National Informatics Center, NIC, to conduct the proceedings. Over to you, Mr. Prakash Kumar.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Kennedy. This particular where I've just started sharing my desktop. I hope it is visible.
It's just coming up, sir.
Okay, then I'll stop my video.
Okay. So while it is coming up, let me first thank the Chamber of Southern India Chamber of Commerce for giving.
So right now it's showing the mails.
Oh my God! So I've already shared.
I think you've shared the screen.
So just give me. I know, but I had changed that. So let me just. So while it's this problem is getting resolved, all I wanted to thank the Southern India Chamber of Commerce for giving me, the whole team from GST and NIC, this opportunity to talk to you people. Also, I would like to thank Mr. Kennedy for his good words, which he talked about GST and NIC. Thank you very much. Generally, we don't hear such words from our stakeholders. Okay, and lastly, I'm not from 75 batch, not that old. I'm from 85 batch. Okay, so let me try to share my screen again. I hope it has come now.
It's coming, sir.
Is it visible? Pankaj, can you confirm?
Not yet, sir. It's still dark. We got it, sir. Now it's visible.
It's visible.
Okay. Yeah. So Mr. Sriram talked about that this is a compliance measure. So I thought I'll start with this particular slide, that the intent is not compliance. Intent is to improve ease of doing business, which was also touched upon by our colleague, Mr. Kennedy. See, current, and he also explained that today, even if you issue invoices in electronic form, there is lots of data entry involved, because our systems are different. So even if it is generated in electronic format, the schema is not same. So whatever is generated by one ERP cannot be read by other. And that leads to increased cost of invoice processing, increased cost of internal, loss of control on internal controls, and turnaround of payment time and things of that sort. The reporting to tax department for so-called control of evasion is just a byproduct of that. And there are two models in the world which primarily people have gone for the first part, but there are many countries who have gone for the second. And now there is a convergence of both models happening. So what you see down below is there are the advantages of e-invoice, which is accuracy and reconciliation, because there is no manual data entry. Whatever comes from the supplier is received by the receiver and goes into her accounting system. It also reduces cost, eliminates paper, improves internal control, and improves capital, better capital management, and of course, better relationship between the supplier and the recipient. Now, while this was happening, I mean, the major reason was that there has to be standard, uniform standard for, so that whatever is generated by one is understood by the other. And I'll just take you to this particular slide. If you recall, a few years back, when the SMS, I mean, 20 years ago or so, SMSs came, and initially everything was in English, and then we started having in Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, etc. And we used to see that whatever was sent, especially in our Indian languages, if the instruments were different, they could not be read. It used to be read as junk. So how does it happen here? You need in between people, or because the service providers could be different. So there is a need for standard, so that whatever is sent in one standard today, and everyone adopts that standard, so the other person also gets in the same format and interpretation is done correctly. So if I just replace the SMSs and say, okay, this is the e-invoice, I am using SAP and my buyer is using Oracle, whatever I send, if it is uniform, they can interpret, that system can interpret and take into the accounting system without any challenge. So that is what the major thing behind is. And apart from that, when everyone reports to the tax department has to understand that, that system has to understand. And unless until there is a standard, it will not happen. And this is what precisely was done by the government by announcing the schema, etc. Now, let me go to, this part was covered by Mr. Kennedy, so let me not. And you can see, even in our region, South Asia, many countries have already gone ahead and they are implementing it. Now, this is a case study from France. What happened when after they introduced e-invoice? If you see the cost of handling one invoice, in paper system, it was 7 euros. It came down to 0.8. So saving was 96%. Number of invoices which could be handled, a paper invoice, around 6,000 invoices in a year by a FT, full-time employee. That increased to 90,000, which is 15 times efficiency and time saving. So this is, the, in fact, they conducted a survey, and this was done by EY. 52% businesses view cost reduction as the principal advantage of a digital transformation. So then we came, your questions, lots of people ask that, how do I comply with this? So there is a, we have created an invoice registration portal set up by NIC since 6th of January this year. Now you, and we have given opportunity to people to integrate and do the testing. So there are two models available today. The taxpayers who are now going to be mandated to provide it, upload invoice data, can do it directly. They can integrate. And I, and let me tell you, large number of them, few thousands have already done out of 48,000. They have done integrated directly, and they are, they have tested, they have generated IRN, they have got signed electronic invoices. Then there are many who will not do it, and they would like to avail services of GST Suvidha provider or other application service provider, or the billing and accounting software system. That also has been enabled. The third one, which I have not mentioned here, is e-commerce operator. That suggestion also came to us that I sell through e-commerce operators as well. Can I? Can they do it on my behalf? We said yes. That also has been enabled by NIC. Now, what is the impact on taxpayers? I was told that they have to do lots of changes. See, for them, the operations remains the same. They will continue to see the same screen. They will generate the invoices the way they are generating today. The changes have been made by the ERP and billing providers. So you have to ensure that your ERP or billing provider does it. In case you have your own IT, which many large companies have, your own accounting home system, then you need to do that. Then the next question was, what are the modes for uploading? So we have provided multiple modes, from API to tool-based, etc., etc. And the last part is, we are also working to put in place a mechanism to enable exchange of signed invoice which the supplier received from IRP with the receiver. So how will it work? Basically, like, you prepare on your accounting, billing, ERP, whatever software you have, and just to ensure that your billing software or your ERP has been updated to so that it generates the electronic invoice in our format, the format which has been approved by the government. And we'll talk about that if we need, we can discuss a little more on that. That is then reported. Once it is reported, our system, IRP system, gives back that they do validations. I was told 40 validations. Now, validations are, what are these validations? Validations are that the GSTN of the supplier has to be correct one. Date has to be in the range. Then other things like your taxable value multiplied by tax rate. Don't you check that? Doesn't your billing software have that? These are the basic things. When you add 10 line items, your sum should be same. Should we not check that? Now, these are some of the things so that we, you don't face problem. And I'm certain all ERPs, billing, accounting, billing softwares have these validations. We have not done anything extra over and above that. Initially, yes, there were some problem on rounding off that we have changed. So, in fact, we have been very responsive based on whatever problems or issues were reported by industry through various associations or directly to us. We have made, NIC has made those changes. Now, once this validation, IRN is generated, a QR code is generated, and that electronic file which came to us, we call it payload, is signed by our IRP, digitally signed, and returned back to the sender. Now that's what that this shows, that you have reported, and this is the digitally signed, which means verified by us, verified for its content. Now what happens? This you can, after that, you can use it to generate a PDF file if your buyer wants. If your buyer wants the signed JSON, you can give signed JSON. If your buyer wants a printed invoice, you can print it. Thereafter, it is between you and your buyer. How and in what format you are going to send it. As I mentioned earlier, we are also working to put in a mechanism like the emails go from, suppose I am on Gmail and you are on Yahoo. How does it go? So that same kind of thing we are working on so that we can provide that mechanism as well, that after you have received signed invoice, you can say send to my recipient and it goes there. Now then what do we do with the invoice information which has come to us? What we do is to use that to populate your GSTR1 and GSTR2A. Now both the things will be done as and when you report. In the beginning, we are going to do it at the end of the day. And it will be visible to you in your GSTR1 and in GSTR2A of your buyer. Now, this is a big improvement. As you all must have noticed recently, in fact, last month and this month, we have started providing PDF document of liability part of 3B based on your GSTR1. And ITC based on your supplier's GSTR1 in the form of 2B. Our aim is to create or auto draft your 3B after 2 months or so, so that it starts flowing in and when you file your GSTR1, after that date, last date, your 2Bs will also be created and your 3B will be drafted, which you, of course, you can edit and file. This is the next step. Once you have started filing electronic invoices, so every day basis, your GSTR1 will keep on populating. Now, what is going to happen? Your GSTR1 will also get auto-drafted for majority of tables except B2C and your advanced table. These two will not be updated, and that is what will have to be done later. Your question will be that why we are not putting B2C invoices, and the reason is that at this stage we want to concentrate first on smaller set of people, and that is why government has decided 48,000. The way we had done e-way bill, we want to start small and perfect it, and then we'll scale it fast. And after a certain time, when government decides that it's the right time, we will also introduce B2C so that your entire GSTR1 can also be created. So this is basically the basic flow. and you get it. Now, number of IRPs, currently we have started with one, which is run by NIC, same agency which has, our government agency, which has also done successfully our e-way bill. And we have also started the process of putting another one to ensure that there is 100% redundancy. Of course, government has approved 10 IRPs, so that tomorrow, as if need be, we can put some more. Now, these are some of the things I thought I will talk about. Few more things. As I mentioned, why it has been done, we have already mentioned. What it means, there is lots of confusion still. People ask me. In fact, I was amazed when one of the consulting companies guys asked me, why don't you take scanned invoices? Now here, e-invoice is nothing but exchange of invoice document in a standard format with the government department as well as with your buyer. That is what it means. And it does not mean generation of invoice on a government portal. You are not going to generate invoice on IRP. It has to be generated in your own system. You're just reporting it. The 500 crore thing, of course, we will come to those question which has been sent. Initially, the way the notification is worded, in a financial year. Now, what the way GST works, we always go back to previous financial year, and that's how we had a GSTN that we had interpreted. But then later on, government told us that, no, that's not the correct interpretation. Interpretation is any financial year starting from implementation of GST in the country, and this has been clarified by us. This FAQ was updated some time back. We have also put it on GST portal where all the taxpayers come, and for benefit of our convenience of taxpayers, we had generated based on 18-19 data, sorry, 19-20 data. However, it is the taxpayer who knows exactly what is his turnover at PAN level. So it is your duty to look at it, and then if you fall into that category and if your name is not there, please go to that portal, invoice portal, and we have made a window there. Just write your GSTN and make a request, and that your GSTN will be enabled for reporting. There's another case also. Suppose you we have created this data, our list of 48,000 based on data filed in GSTR 3B. In case you have some issue with that, and your claim is that my turnover is less than 500, that also you can go and inform there so that we can remove it. What I wanted to tell was that these things we have done for your convenience. The law mandates, and it is the responsibility of the taxpayer to comply with those. Then there are certain sectors government has exempted. These were told by Mr. Sriram. There was some confusion about whether like banking or any sector which has been approved here, if that entity is into working in this area as well as some areas which are not exempted. For example, bank here is exempted, but banking operations, but suppose they are also selling some other goods which are not exempted, will they be required to file or report electronic invoices? We have been recently told by the government, and in fact, that clarification will come from the government, that it is for the entity. So all the banks, since they are engaged in banking, they are exempted, even if for those activities also which are non-banking. Similar will be the case with passenger transport services, etc. This clarification will be provided, but however, I'm just clarifying because this was raised by Mr. Sriram.
It is already in effect.
These are all you are aware of. So with these, what I'll do, I'll request my colleague, Mr. Ravi Kiran Idara, to take over from here and take us through the some of the basic things and the FAQs, important additional new FAQs which we have put in last 1 week on the portal. Though we had shared with Sikki yesterday the complete list of FAQs and other resources, and I'm sure they must, you must have got it. However, if you have any question, please keep it right in the chat so that at the end we can take it up during the day. Over to you, Ravi.
Thank you, sir. Very good morning to all the participants. So my first posting was in Chennai for 6 years. So I'm very glad that many participants are from Chennai. And now I'm just going to share you. I'm sure you are able to see my screen.
Yes, Ravi.
So
Ravi, you can see, but your voice is getting fading sometimes. So, and you can just go through this quickly. Yeah.
Yes. So it is already said that the presently the supplier is issuing the invoice directly to the buyer. Now in the invoicing scenario, the supplier will first send the invoice in JSON format to the notified portal. And the notified portal will give back the signed invoice JSON along with IRN, which is embedded in a QR code. Once this is received by the supplier, then he will issue the e-invoice. E-invoice has no legal definition, but whatever invoice copy which was duly reported to the notified portal and which is having the QR code, which in turn has the IRN, is generally referred as e-invoice. So now the supplier issues this e-invoice to the buyer. You may please note that here e-invoice may not be in the present scenario. It may not be electronic also. Even if, for example, a supplier is giving an invoice in paper copy, PDF, email, whatever it is, it should have the mandatory QR code which contains IRN. So that is called e-invoice. Then we have to start from basics actually, because many are getting confused. The law, what it says, as per the newly inserted rule 48.4, it says that the notified class of registered persons, we have already seen who they are, they have to prepare invoice by uploading particulars as mentioned in INV01. And where they have to upload, it is on invoice registration portal. Presently it is one, tomorrow there will be many. And they have to obtain an invoice reference number. And after following this e-invoicing process, they will issue the e-invoice in the usual way as they are doing now. Then two more important legal provisions is that the invoice issued by notified person, wherever that e-invoicing is applies, if they issue in any other manner. So it is not an invoice at all. Forget about validity or not valid. It is not an invoice in the eyes of GST law. This is clearly mentioned. And where invoicing is applicable, issuing of invoice in duplicate, triplicate, it is presently there. But wherever this is applicable, invoicing is applicable, this is not at all required. So e-invoice is not about a soft copy or generation by a government portal. And to whom it is applicable, it is already told. And supplies and documents covered. See, it is invoices, credit notes, and debit notes. So if anyone are issuing invoices and credit notes and debit notes under the GST law, the e-invoicing is applicable. And what are the supplies covered? B2B, that is supplies to the registered persons, supplies to SEZs, exports, and deemed exports. B2C supplies are not covered now. And if you report, IRP will be rejecting it. Then the process we have already seen, it will continue, the taxpayers will continue to create their invoices in their accounting systems, and they'll be reporting to IRP, IRN and QR code you will get. And then the invoice can be issued to the receiver with QR code in the same way as it is being done now. A GST invoice, wherever invoicing is applicable, it will be valid only with a valid IRN. So this is one of the most frequently asked questions. Many people are feeling that I have to go to a website and I have to fill a kind of form and I will generate an invoice. But in e-invoice scenario, we are primarily talking about machine to machine exchange of data. It is between the supplier's accounting system and the IRP, the e-invoice portal. So the exchange of the exchange of invoice data happens between machine to machine. But of course, tomorrow you may see that the invoicing may be extended to small taxpayers. When that happens, a web-based screen or even a mobile app where the small taxpayers can enter their details one by one and then report to the IRP and then generation of IRN, this also will be provided. But presently, it is mainly through APIs. So as CEO GSTN has told, the invoice ensures electronic exchange of invoices also. Presently, the schema is notified statutorily by way of INV-01. So the beauty of this INV-01 is that it has all the typical elements of a commercial invoice catering to all businesses. And it is global also. It is based on the PEPPOL standard, which is used very popularly used in across the world, and its popularity is even growing. So this schema ensures that this e-invoice is machine readable and interoperable, so that invoice can be exchanged between different systems, different businesses, so that they can readily get ingested into the accounting systems of the suppliers. So I'll just take you through the detailed flow of the e-invoice, which will give you the clarity as to how the whole process works. So presently there is a supplier who is a notified person. He should have a system or an offline utility. For example, he may have his own ERP or billing account solution, or he can simply download the offline utility given on the IRP website. It is called bulk generation tool. So this can be downloaded, which is like any other return preparation utility. It is an Excel utility. Using that, he can easily prepare his JSON. And then the supplier uploads this JSON to the IRP as per the prescribed schema. Now, the e-invoice portal receives this data through B2G APIs. And what IRP does, it validates the invoice data so that it is clean, and it generates IRN, which is unique for that document, for that financial year. And it sends the invoice payload, that is the invoice data, to the GST system. Now the data reaches the GST system. Now GST system saves the invoice data, including the IRNs, and also it rules out the existence of same IRN in the GST system, so that the deduplication, what we call as deduplication, is confirmed, so that the IRN is unique. Now, after this is confirmed by the GST system, the IRP adds a QR code, quick response code, and then signs the invoice JSON, that is, it adds the digital signature, and it pushes the data to e-way bill system wherever the supplier has asked for the e-way bill. Then the supplier receives the signed JSON with IRN, and if he has asked for e-way bill, he can get that e-way bill JSON also. And then, as usual, the e-invoice will be issued to the buyer. And now, presently, there is only one IRP, which is run by NIC. Tomorrow, there can be many. So what the GST system does is, it acts as a central repository for these e-invoices. So all the invoice data, including IRNs, will be stored in this GST system. And it also auto-populates the invoice details into GSTR1 of the supplier and GSTR2A of the respective buyers. And now this buyer, with the QR code on the invoice copy, or even he can upload the entire e-invoice JSON, whatever he might have received by email from the supplier. So he can upload this into the, there is an option on IRP where he can upload the signed JSON and verify its authenticity. means whether it was duly reported to IRP and whether the IRN is valid or not. So this completes the e-invoicing process. Now I request my colleague, Mr. Pankaj Deekshit, to kindly take you through the auto population of e-invoice into GSTR 1. Pankaj ji, I think you are not audible.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. As explained here, once the e-invoice is received by the IRP system, the IRP system will push this to the GST system, which is going to be the single repository of all invoices from this IRP as well as multiple IRPs. Once the GST system has received this e-invoice, it will auto-populate the GSTR1 as you have been filling it for the last 3 years and plus. So all the data will be taken from the INV01 received by the GST system from the IRP, and the various tables as shown will be populated. So the B2B supplies, the credit debit notes, the exports, and the HSN and the relevant tables which are associated with that will get populated. That is table number 4A, B, C, 6B, and 6C for B2B invoices, table 6A for export invoices, table 9B for the credit and debit notes, and table 12 for the HSN summary. The GST system will do the mapping of the fields and on aggregate items rate and populate the GSTR1. Now the GST system will also handle the cancellation of e-invoice and remove the auto-populated items in case the e-invoice is cancelled within the relevant timelines and duration which have been specified. In case a taxpayer needs to edit any information in the GSTR1, that will be allowed through the going into the GST system. Next slide, please, Ravi. Now, it might happen that the suppliers upload the invoices directly into the GST system as they are doing currently for preparing the GSTR1, or they may follow the route of the IRP. In case such duality is noticed, then due to the faster population of the invoices in the GST system via GSTR1, that will be taken as the final one. And because the IRP flow will take a little time, we will discard that. So this is to overcome in case there are two routes of invoices coming into the GST system. So the preferred will be whatever has been uploaded through the GSTR1 route, that will be taken. In case a taxpayer edits the invoice after auto-population and later cancels his IRN, then the edited invoice will not be removed from GSTR system because it was edited by the taxpayer. So all edited portions will be retained in the GST system. We will also provide through the GST system APIs, because sellers and buyers will need to pull all the e-invoices which have been populated. So this mechanism will be provided in due course via APIs. Subsequently, as we go forward, the GSTR1, GSTR2A, GSTR2B, 6A, etc., and offline tools will all include IRN as well as the IRN date, because these will be important parameters to have in the invoice details as to when they were created and what was the date of creation. Now, even though we are attempting right from now that the IRP will push the data into the GST system on a real-time basis, but as we are going in phases, and to start with, this reconciliation of all the invoices pushed from the IRP to the GST system will be done on a nightly basis, once every night. So you may not immediately see your GSTR1 auto-populated with your e-invoice data. That will happen subsequently in the T plus one. That is, if you upload the e-invoice into the IRP today, you will be able to see it in the GSTR1 on the next day. However, going forward, this will happen on an almost near real-time basis. Next slide, please. So as we have already talked about that there will be data from the e-invoice populated into the GSTR1. These are the parameters which will be picked up from the e-invoice and populated into the GSTR1. The column on the left shows the e-invoice parameters, and the column on the right shows the GSTR1 fields where it will get go and be populated. So you are all aware of such parameters like supplier type code, document type code, reverse charge, supplier trading name, etc., HSN code in table 12. Next, please. All these details are also available on the sandbox as well as the production portal of the invoice, and they can be taken up from there also. Next, please. What I want to simply to shortly cover right now is access mechanism, because we receive a lot of queries on that. So as we have already heard a number of times today, and you're already aware that the applicability of invoice, e-invoice, is for businesses which have annual aggregate turnover more than 500 crores since 2017 till now. And that's on an aggregate basis per PAN. So these entities are obviously entitled to generate e-invoice and use the IRP system. Now, IT, these companies may also be having either internal IT functions who provide these facilities, or they could be having ISVs, that is software vendors, who provide this. Any companies which are serving these 500 crore companies, they can use the GSTNs of these 500 crore plus companies to access the e-invoice portal. In addition to that, we already know that as everybody uses some or the other ERP like SAP or Oracle or Marg or Busy or Tally or Zoho, etc., which are there in the country. Such ERP and accounting and billing systems will be provided access to the production system so that the necessary invoicing can be done. We lastly, we already have a large ecosystem of GST Suvidha providers and ASPs. These ecosystem partners will continue to be allowed to use the IRP system because they've been serving the businesses for a large amount of time, and they're very well familiar and aware of the compliance requirements. Now, next slide, please. So these being the entitled ecosystem or people who will be allowed access to the IRP system, here you can see the URLs. I'm sure you would already either use them, and subsequently Mr. Bhatt from NIC will also give you more details. So details of all the e-invoicing mechanisms, the technical parameters, the APIs, the schemas, the table mapping, etc., and a lot of help videos are also available on these URLs. You're requested to kindly go and visit them. Thank you, Ravi. Over to you.
So there are some FAQs which I'll cover at the end before the question answer session. Now I request Sri Bhatji from NIC to kindly deliver his portion.
Good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Whether my presentation is also audible?
Yes.
Presentation
yes.
Is visible?
Yeah, we can see. Yes. We can see your presentation. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you. Good morning to all of you. I am PV Bhatt, Deputy Director General from NIC. We are working on the e-invoice system. I'll go through the complete the production and sandbox facilities or highlights of the system what we have provided on the portal now. So this is about our NIC. NIC is the Government of India organization. We are working with state government and central government, and we are providing large number of e-governance solutions on various platform or various purposes. And we are closely working with the taxation department, as you are already aware. Customs is one of the system where NIC is running, and it is working very smoothly. VAT and professional tax, sale tax, already we have worked during the previous regime when the VAT were there. E-Waybill system is run by NIC only. Last 2.5 years, it is absolutely smoothly running. Now we are working on the e-invoice system. e-way bill system, again, as you know, it is required for the value more than 50,000 goods, which is being moved. In fact, from our portal, every day we are generating 22 lakhs of e-way bills from the system for last 2.5 years. More than 138 crores e-way bills have been generated. In fact, we have geared up for equal number of e-invoices going to be generated from October 1st from this portal. Our infrastructure, everything is ready on the production. So the people have started using it. So I'll not cover this. Already it has been covered. This is also has been covered. So now again, invoice related points, already this also has been covered. I'll skip this. Well, when IRN request you make it to the e-invoice system, you will get the following four things. When you prepare your invoice in your ERP system or accounting system, after preparation of that through the API or the whatever the mechanism you're having, you will request the e-invoicing system for the IRN. When the details comes into the e-invoice system validate the complete invoice. Then after that, it prepares one IRN, give back the IRN to the your request. With that, it also gives the e-way bill if you are requested for e-way bill. You can note that in one request, you can also generate the IRN, you can also generate the e-way bill. No need of preparing the e-way bill separately, because already part A of the e-way bill is available in the e-invoice. That data will be taken. Only you have to pass the vehicle number and other things will be taken care. Then also it provides the signed QR code. Signed QR code is whatever the QR code to be printed on invoice, it will be provided, which you can take and put it on your invoice and take it further. Signed invoice. The IRP, NIH IRP will sign the invoice, whatever you have provided, and signed invoice, it will be given back to you in the package, in the file format, so that you can preserve it or pass on to your buyer or whatever process you are there, that can be taken care. QR code contains the various things. Already it is there in the portal. I'll not go into the detail again. Okay. Now, modes of invoice generation. This is one of the important requests or the kind of a questions will be raised by the people. How I can generate invoice? What are the modes are available? Currently, we have provided the three ways in which e-invoice can be generated. One is the offline tool. You can go to the portal, our portal, log in there. There is a tool available in Excel format. Whatever invoice you have prepared in your Excel format, in your system, cut and paste it to that Excel. Excel will prepare the file to be uploaded into e-invoice portal. You upload that and e-invoices will be generated in one go for maybe 50 invoices or 100 invoices. So this will simplify your process of a bulk generation of the e-invoices. If you are not comfortable to go with the API direct integration, initially want to start with the offline tool, you can do that. Prepare all the invoice as per the format, upload into the portal. You will in one go, you will get all the details and you can take and put it back to your system and continue the thing. Second one is the direct API integration. This is available only for the taxpayer whose aggregate turnover is more than 500 crore. So those taxpayers can directly integrate their system, their ERP system or accounting system with the e-invoice system. So directly they will be given access wherein they can directly send the request and get back the request, IRN request back from the system, response back from the system. The last one is the API integration through the GSP. The third method is there are some 55 to 59 GSPs are there, which has been identified by GSTN. So we have provided access to them. You can tie up with them. Through them you can send. Your system will send the request to GSP. GSP system will send it to the IRN's request. IRN will be processed and IRP will give back the request to you. So these are the three methods available through which you can generate the e-invoice. So as one of the Mr. Sriram was telling, lot of validations are there, as already Prakash Kumar sir has told that these validations are all the basic validations. What you are doing in your ERP system or what is required as per the GST law, which has to be taken care. That basic validation only has been applied here. As per that, everybody has streamlined with that and all the validation has been expected. Large number of people have started generating the IRN using the portal. As already indicated, B2C transactions are not being accepted in a e-invoicing system presently. Now, cancellation of IRN. Once you generate the IRN from the portal, within 24 hours, you can cancel it. There is a provision window available, like what you do in the e-way bill. Similarly, for IRN also, you can cancel within 24 hours. However, cancellation is not possible if valid e-way bill exists on that IRN. If you have generated IRN, subsequently generated e-way bill also, just if you want to cancel the IRN, it is not possible because e-way bill is already exist. So you have to cancel e-way bill, then cancel IRN, the process, both the things will be closed. Then last one is, the e-invoice, once it is cancelled, it cannot be generated on the same invoice number. That is, I am having an invoice number 122. I have generated one IRN, and afterwards I noticed that there is some mistake. So I will go back to the portal, cancel the IRN. Then again, I will send the 122 only, the invoice, with the changed information. Now system will not generate IRN. It says that already IRN generated for this and it has been cancelled. You have to prepare the fresh invoice as per the accounting practice and send the new request. That is the process you have to follow. Then e-way bill, e-invoice seamlessly integrated. Whenever together they generate, immediately when the e-invoice you generate and e-way bill you generate, immediately e-way bill will be given back and it will be available on the e-way bill system for further updation of a vehicle detail or extension or cancellation or any other purpose. So both are tightly integrated. So it seamlessly, you don't find out any variation in the data availability in both these systems. So this is one of the things, as already you are aware, 5th August, we have launched the sandbox portal for the API and the offline generation, which has been used by a large number of people now, and they are regularly generating. And in fact, nowadays we are seeing around 4 lakh, 5 lakh, 6 lakh IRNs are generated every day throughout the India. People are accustomed to that and they are generating. They are well versed with the system now. In fact, we have released the production site also on August 15th. And more number of people have registered there and tested there, and they are ready for to go from October 1st. And as October 1st is a live scenario, the whole infrastructure, everything is ready to take it further on that. Now I'll go to the portal quickly and tell what are the facilities are available on the production portal for the taxpayer on the e-invoicing. You can see when you open the portal, e-invoice1.gst.gov.in, you can see the following information. Help is there. In the help, various things are. FAQs are there. You can go and see the FAQs. Tools are available. Signed invoice variation things are there. Updated details are available. And also brief notes are available. Computer videos are available. Help videos are available. Various things like introduction to the e-invoicing system, how to generate a bulk, how to use the bulk tool, how to do the API registration. So all these things are there. You can download, understand how the system is working and take it further on that. And also FAQs on technical aspect. Whatever the details are there for FAQ, all the FAQ related to the e-invoicing technical details are available. You can take that and understand, and whatever technical things are required, you can do. One of the regular requests nowadays are coming. Some people are asking how to get the production access. Can I have a multiple username and password? All the details we are provided on this portal. One can go through that, understand the complete technicality details available for the related to the e-invoice. Then how to know whether I have been enabled for the e-invoicing or not? So GSTN has already listed out, based on the R3B data, those who have crossed 500 crore turnover in the last one of the 3 years. As per that, the data has been populated in that. If you enter your GSTN number, system will tell whether you have been enabled or not. Based on that, you know whether you have been enabled or not, and you can take appropriate action based on this. Next, if I have not been enabled, but I have to get, because already my 500 crore, my turnover is more than 500 crore, but system has not been enabled for whatever reason. So now I have a provision on the portal where I can go and get it enabled myself for my system. Because rule says any person, any taxpayer, and any company which has crossed 500 crore has to generate the e-invoice. Whether the system has provided or not, he knows the things, he has to go there and register and do. So when you come to this, you have to enter your GSTN ID. Once GSTN ID is entered, OTP will be sent to your mobile number. After OTP is sent, once OTP authentication is done, system will tell for that company what are the other GSTN linked are there. All the details will tell. Then in last 3 years, that is 17, 18, 18, 19, 19, 20, whichever year you have passed 500 crore, select that year and enter the amount which has crossed 500 crore. Then submit, so you are enabled for the e-invoicing system. You can start generating the IRNs for your system. However, it will be available in the sandbox next day. So this is the way one can enable, because there are a large number of questions people are saying that, no, I have not been told as enabled, but I have crossed 500 crore. This option, you can go to the portal yourself, you can self-registration, you can do, enter the detail, and you will be enabled for the e-invoicing system. Similarly, if somebody has not been enabled, but he is below 500 crore, if I have been enabled, but I am below 500 crore, my turnover is there, then I can call the GSTN help desk, raise my grievance saying that I have been enabled for the e-invoice, but my turnover is less than 500 crore. They will take the complaint, they will verify and update back you what is the status of your enablement. So next one is the bulk generation tool. As I told you, the people who have used the e-way bill, on the same line, we are having the bulk generation tool. We are having the different categories of the bulk generation tool. Once you want to generate only B2B, SEZ, export, deemed export only, then you can do this. Or you want to do in a separate seed, the separate provision is there. The next third format is you want to cater to all requirement, and also you enter all the references detail of whatever there in the invoice. Those things can be done. So multiple formats are there. Go to the portal, go through the video and understand that and start using it. And large number of people have started already using this thing. And this is the tool, how it is looks like. It gives the basic information about the generation of the invoicing, and also it explains about the attribute, what is there, what has to be entered. And this is the screen. It will tell you what are the details you have to enter. And also it will, you can profile your requirement. Like, for example, I am not having a reverse charges. You mentioned that I am not having a reverse charges, so that column will not be asked for you. If you are not selling to e-commerce operator, you say that I am not selling, so that column will be disabled. All the validation detail will be there. This is how the data you will populate on the Excel form. Excel has a validate button. You will validate through this. And also, you can click a prepare JSON. When you click a prepare JSON, JSON file will be prepared like this. This JSON file will be stored on your system. Then you can use the tool and upload and generate the IRN. I'll come back to that later. This is the tool utilization, how it looks like. Now I am coming back here. You have a registration here. If already you are registered for the e-way bill system, same username password can be used to log into the e-invoice also. The single sign-on mechanism we have provided for e-way bill and e-invoice. The same username and password can be used for both of the purposes. If you are service sector, obviously you might not have used the e-way bill. You can go and register here and generate your username and password. Then using the login, you can log into the system. Once you log, registration portion, when you register, you have to enter your GSTN ID, OTP will come to your mobile number. Once OTP is authenticated, you will create your username and password and you can log in using that. Once you log into the portal, these are the details. You can see here, this is the screen. You can see e-invoice, MIS report, user management, API registration, which you will be using. And also e-way bill generation. Based on IRN, you can generate e-way bill here rather than going to the e-way bill portal. Then subsequently, this is the bulk generation of IRN. Once you have prepared the using the tool, the IRN file, the generation file, you upload here. Once it is uploaded the file, system will read that the data and it will tell in this file 100 invoices are there. And number of items all together is 100. Each invoice is having one item, then it is saying like that. Then invoice uploaded successfully, which has been validated, verified. There are 90 invoices which have been accepted and IRNs are generated. 10 have been failed. So Ken has been trained indicating that there is some validation problem or the schema is not correct that has been failed. So here you can see those lists also successfully available IRN failed. Both the Excel will be available. You can download this Excel into Excel format, or you can download the signed JSON also. All the 90 signed JSON you can download, store it in your system and use it as per your requirement. Now this is e-invoice. Once you have printed, how to print? This is how the e-invoice looks like once you print from the portal. It is not that you have to print from the portal only. Please carry out your business as you are doing. You need not have to print as per this format. You continue as per your printing format, because your print will have the company emblem, all other information, terms and conditions, so many other things you want to communicate to your recipient. You can put all of them and do. Only thing is that you have to put this QR code on your invoice. Find out the suitable place and put this QR code on your invoice and issue to the buyer. That is the only changes you have to do. This is the, and you can put wherever the space is available. Not that you have to put it in the top corner or bottom corner kind of a thing. Wherever QR code can be put, you put the readable QR code so that, and you can issue the invoice to the recipient. This is the cancel. Again, the cancellation is simple. You enter based on the acknowledgement of our IRN number. The details will be shown and you can cancel on the portal. And generation of a e-way bill. Again, it is simplified. You enter the acknowledgement number, IRN number of the IRN number for whatever you have generated. All the details will be populated and shown to you. Only you have to enter the transporter detail or the vehicle detail and e-way bill will be generated. This is how the e-way bill will look like when it is generated from IRN. It is similar to the e-way bill generally what you generate. This is some MIS reports available. The data, whatever you uploaded and generated, is available only for 2 days on the IRP portal. After that 2 days old data, you cannot see. You will get all this data in a GSTR1 from the GSTN portal. So this is again whitelisting of IP. If I want to directly integrate with the e-invoicing system, I can go there and give my 4 IPs, public IPs from my ERP system, which has to link it to that. This has to be, whitelisting has to be done on our side. So that will be taking care. You will upload your test report also. This will be processed and you will be client ID, client secret will be sent to you. The integration of the sister concern. Once you have created a client ID, client secret, then your sister companies can be linked to that client ID, client secret. In the portal, the procedure is available and you can do that, and that people also can be start generating the IRN. This is the integration with the GSP. This is further simple. You can say that you are linking through the GSP. Just enter. You need not have to whitelist. If you are linking through the GSP, you need not have to whitelist your IP. Only you have to go there, generate your username and password. This is important. This username and password belongs to your GSTN. Using this will be validated. And yeah, e-invoice will be generated based on this. And also note that you can link with the multiple GSPs. And for each GSP, you will create a separate username and password. And other than that, portal also has a facility to verify the e-invoices. There are two mechanisms available. QR code mobile app is available. You can download QR code mobile app, put it on your mobile, and QR code can be validated or JSON file can be validated. Similarly, if you have a JSON file on your system, upload, verify signature, signed invoice is there, upload the signed invoice, it will verify enter. Here you can see, this is the uploaded signature, signed file I uploaded, it is verified and showing me the invoice. This is the QR code app. In the mobile app, you can see the two buttons available, verify QR code, verify signed invoice. When you click a verify QR code will be read and details will be shown here. When you verify signed invoice, you tell, you will upload the file and you can see the invoice. So now I'll quickly go through in the 2 minutes about the portal. We have a wonderful API sandbox portal. It is an online tool kind of a thing. Your developers or your the ERP solution provider can use this and test all the APIs required to be integrated into ERP system. I'll not go into the detail. Here you can see the complete various information related to the integration is available. You can see the authentication, how it has to be done. IRN generation, how it has to be done. What are the details? Schema, validation, cancellation, how it has to be done. All the details are available. Here you can see the resources. What is IRN? Then mapping of notified schema with the API schema, e-way bill schema, master details. And here it is there also, onboarding procedure, API credentials, how to get the API. All the details required for the integration. I'm not going to these details because it is too technical. So I'm just telling, you can tell your ERP or the developers to go through this portal, understand. We have also given some sample programming code. You can use that code and they can build their system also. So this has a step-by-step interfaces, it will tell. First level, what happens? When you encryption, what happens? When you decrypt, what happens? Every detail is available here. So your developer can understand these interfaces within 2 days. Completely, it can integrate and go it further on that. You need not have to struggle much. So this is about my portal website, which I hosted. So all the details, and these are the, on the portal already, we are having the portal detail I have mentioned, and we are having the email ID also. If you have any doubt, you can send the email so that you will get back the reply with the details. Thank you. That covers my presentation.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bhatt. So what we can do, we can straightway go to some of the questions which have been shared by Sikki team, as well as those which have been put in the chat box. So let me just share my screen where I have put it. Just hold on, Ravi. Let me just take this and.
Sir, I have put them here, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, so I hope my Excel sheet is visible to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let me first go through 9 issues which was shared with us, and then there were suggestions, and then I have at the bottom the chat ones. The first one is it mandatory to generate EINV for nil supply items in case invoice carries both taxable and nil rated? See, the answer is very simple. We should go into the basic. It's a B2B invoice. Yes, it has to be reported. What is inside is not important. Important is whether it is a business to business invoice. Number two, whether e-invoice is required for financial credit note and debit note. Again, the notification says all kinds of credit note, debit notes. So our understanding is that yes, any credit note or debit note which is issued will be relevant here or will be covered under this. Third one is whether e-invoice is required for invoices to government departments, as most of them are registered. So the government department can fall under 3 categories. One, where it doesn't have any kind of registration detail from the GST system, which means it is neither a deductor nor a regular registered taxpayer. In that case, it will not be because it's not required. The second scenario is the government department is engaged in providing goods and services. And in that capacity, it has a regular taxpayer's registration as well as a deductor. In that case, please specify the regular taxpayer's GST in your invoice. The third category is the tax deductor's GST. What we have been told that to advise you all that you should mention that, and that will also help us to, in fact, that we can use later to create GSTR7 for the tax department, for the government departments, which they can use it and create their GSTR7. So that's the idea here. Number four, whether export supply is to be covered legally as per notification, since it is for supply to registered person. It has been clarified since beginning itself. And if there is a need, this clarification will be issued. Here, the logic what I understand is that there is no registered buyer or recipient, and hence your argument is that it should not be covered, but they have specifically mentioned that all export supplies, even to those which are made to SEZ are covered under this and have to be reported. The threshold part I have explained earlier, it was our understanding that we had done it only for the previous financial year, but later on government clerk told us that it is any financial year. It says in a financial year, which means any financial year starting from 1/7/17 when GST came into operation. This is at PAN level, and all the turnovers of various GSTs had to be added together, and that is how we have also computed and created that list. Whether e-invoicing is mandatory if turnover exceeds in any financial year, owing to recent clarification, whether turnover exceeds, as I have explained above earlier. Whether for high C sales and bonded warehouse sales, e-invoice is required. We will get back after having consultation with the policy wing of CBIC. So we have noted it down and we'll also update in the FAQ. Number 8, whether e-invoicing is required for transactions between two branches of the same legal entity in case of entity is exempted from e-invoicing, such as banks. So as I mentioned in my presentation, recently this was discussed by a committee of officers, which is called Law Committee, having representatives from central and state government. And we had raised, lots of industry participants had raised whether a bank, if they are doing some activity which is not covered under notification of exemption, will they be required to report that? So after a discussion, they have clarified to us that the entity is exempted. It is qua entity and not qua activity. So once that is there, then the intra branches will not be required. For a previously issued B2C invoice, say August 2020, there can be situation whether the buyer will have GST in subsequently with a request to convert. Here the acid test is, what will be the date of invoice? Now, when you made supplies, if the person was not a GST in holder, you are not issuing invoice, you are issuing only bill of supply. Once that buyer gets the GST in, and it depends when from which particular date it is there, and the GST rules are very, very clear when the supplier in that case has to issue an invoice, GST invoice, replacing the bill of supplies given earlier. So please do that. So it's basically, if it is prior to October 1st, it will not be. If it is after October 1st, it will have to be reported. Then certain suggestions have come. I will try to give my views on this, and my colleagues, please join me. One is, presently there is no check in NIC portal that runs a check on whether IRB generated before e-way bill generation. Now, my understanding is that this is not done because IRN generation is only for those having annual aggregate turnover above 500 crores. So if they put this check in e-way bill, then for all others, e-way bill will be stopped. So that could be one of the reasons that it has not been put. However, once e-invoice becomes mandatory for everyone, then we will put this check that any request coming to e-way bill portal has to have an IRN. However, just to be sure, let me invite my colleague, Mr. Bhatt. Bhattji, if you have anything else to comment on this.
Yes, sir. To add to what you are told is basically what we are saying is we don't want to create a confusion or trouble to the taxpayer when they are starting the IRN generation. The first day, if I start blocking e-way bill, there will be a kind of a confusion. So now currently we are allowing you generate IRN, e-way bill also separately. But in e-way bill, anyway, we are having a check for the invoice number duplicate. It is not allowed. Even if you generate through IRN and go for e-way bill, duplicate check is there anyway. But government very clearly say that IRN has to be generated before movement of the goods. So obviously, IRN has to be generated, e-way bill has to be generated. Now, presently, for a couple of months, we have not put that check. Gradually, as we go along, as you CEO has suggested, we are adding after 2 months this check also. All the B2B transaction for e-way bill generation will not be available if IRN is not generated. So it will come in after two months or so.
Thank you, Bharatji. The next one is NIC portal follows 2017 HSN classification, and such is not aligned with customs. In fact, we have recently taken the latest HSN list from customs, and we are synchronizing not only e-way bill, e-invoice, and also GST system. So all of them will follow exactly what we have in whatever has been approved by the customs department. So that work is underway and it will be done quickly. The next one is the surcharge insurance freight required to be added to taxable value as such are to be provided in a separate column. Adding it to the base price or including a separate line item is a cumbersome process. The invoice. So now I just wanted to understand, how are you doing it today? Can anyone, the person who has sent it, can you just explain how it is treated in ERP today? And if not now, what I can suggest that if Sikki could send us a little more data and how the ERPs, the big ERPs are handling it, what is the challenge in that? Maybe we'll be able to respond better on that. Similarly, the second one is the invoice printed from NIC owing to the surcharge freight insurance are not matching the actual invoice copy, thereby leading to distortion and challenges. So these two, we need some more information, and please send it to us quickly so that we can get it examined. Also, consult government so that there is no confusion on this part.
So, Prakash Kumati,
please, if you can just tell us, yes.
Yeah, Sriram here. So, yeah. Basically, there are a couple of practices which are there seen in the industry. One is where the freight and other charges are shown in invoices today. The other practice is not to show in the invoice because they aggregate everything and then they will not show it as part of the line item as part of the invoice itself. So what is happening in the second case is that they are forced to back work as part of the unit price these charges if they do not want to show a line item of these freight charges and then increase the unit price to that extent. The other practice is that they show it in a column or form wherever they want to show surcharge and freight and insurance and not in the line item form in a row format. So it is not coming as a row line item, but it is in the column. After the line items are being populated, it is shown in the column. So whichever way it is that it is not possible for them to either disclose or back work and disclose as part of the unit quantity price and then arrive at the taxable value. And that's the practice which we are seeing today. We can certainly, sir, send you copies of some of these invoices as sample. So yeah, you can consider it and then see what is the better way of disclosing these things.
So that will be great if you can send us some your details the way you explained.
Yes.
And an example and how it is being treated so that we can advise you. One small thing which I would like to tell you here is that INV1 and what the Rule 46 provides. Now, INV1 is the complete schema which takes care of all practices which are followed by various kinds of industry in our country today. And as Ravi had mentioned earlier, we took up PayPal, which is based on universal business language, something which has been adopted by a large number of countries across the world as our base. And we have done minor changes and added some of the things which are peculiar to our country and our practices by our trade and industry. And that's there we had taken help of ICI who and their members, they had helped us in doing that. Now, there are two parts there. One is mandatory part, and others are optional parts. And there are some, if you optional part, if you click, then certain relevant parts of that optional box becomes mandatory. Now, this is what the requirement is. Now, if something is not relevant to you, you don't fill up if it is optional. Now, one is what you report to e-invoice portal, or that is IRP. And the second part is what you print, whether it's a PDF or on paper. These two are, can be different. I just wanted to clarify that in different meaning, that all the things which are there, in fact, people have asked that should we print that 180 or 160 items. Our answer there is no. Only the minimum requirement which is there in rule GST rules, that 46, is what needs, rule 46 needs to be printed. Or when it, you are giving it to your buyer. In addition, if it, he has, there is something other in your contract, payment terms, this, that, one, you can all add that. So we just wanted to clarify these two are two different requirements. Here the reporting is that this is my total line by line item to whom sales, supply is made, which date, invoice number, etc., etc. And as per the INV1, what you print and give to your buyer, at least minimum those which are there in as per rule 46 have to be there. There we are getting QR code added by suitable notification so that it also gets a place there.
Right.
What I understood was here that NIC also enables you to print the whole thing, but what you get is only a string of QR code. Now it's your ERP, your billing software has to interpret that and create the QR code and print it if it is required to be printed or if it has to be converted into a PDF. And as Mr. Bhatt was mentioning, you can put it on left, right, above the name, below the name. We are not bothered. Till the time it contains exact information which has come, so that when it is read, the reader knows whether this has IRN and other those 8-9 details which are present in the QR code, and it is not tampered with. That is what we are interested in. Okay, the next line 18 is amortization and other inclusion in taxable value are to be captured separately. Else it would lead to mismatch between actual invoice and NIC invoice print. Now again here we need some more inputs with some samples. And
definitely.
That this, and what I'll suggest, give us, this is the practice, this is how ERPs are handling it.
Sure. So
that will help us to understand what exactly you are saying. Now what I'll do, I'll just go to the whatever has been put in the chat. Ravi, what you can do after this, the last line item, if you can copy from chat in another Excel, and then you can share, and we will, because I had stopped copying up around 5-7 minutes back.
Yes, sir.
Number one, e-invoicing portal, there was an issue with QR code generation, JWT signature issue was there. Whether it is sorted out now, sir. So, Bhatji, if you can explain this, number 22.
Yes. Yes, it has been sorted out, sir. One can easily verify now that has been taken care now. Long back only it has been there.
Okay. Whether HSN code, 8-digit code can be pushed into IRN portal for all invoices, including export invoice. Bhatji?
Yes, it can be entered, sir. 8-digit is also acceptable. 4-digit, 6-digit, 8-digit, as per the HSN master, they are allowed to take it for IRN generation.
Thank you, Bhatji. Next, whether HSN code appearing in GST tariff, custom tariff is as such available in production server of e-invoice portal, since most of the HSN codes for our products does not find a place. Way forward, whether this issue will be resolved or will have all HSN code. Now, my suggestion is if you can tell us which are the HSN codes as per your experience, which are there in custom tariff code, and not available in production server of e-invoice or e-way bill or GST system. If you can share that with us, because we are in the process of synchronizing. And if there is such a case, we would like to know so that we can quickly resolve it. So my request to the person who had put it, please send it to us. And Ravi, can you just give that email ID, put it in the chat where they can send the details?
Sure, sir.
So all your suggestions or any further, you can just send it to the email ID, which Ravi is putting in the chat box.
Sure, Mr.
Next, number 25. Companies collect freight and insurance as separate line item in tax invoice currently prepared. I think this is the one which we have discussed earlier. So it will come with that. Number 26. Rule 48.6 amended to provide that the provisions of subrule 1 and 2 shall not apply to an invoice prepared in the manner specified in subrule 4. Which means any one of the invoice copy with QR code will suffice for transportation of goods from factory to customer. Whether our understanding is correct.
if the person who has written it, if you can just speak, what is your concern here? That if you have a QR code and the soft copy which has come from the IRC, will that suffice, or should I need to print an invoice copy and carry? Is that the question?
Yes, sir. The question is actually clear in earlier regime. GST invoice, original duplicate and triplicate copies were there. So we necessarily need to send the duplicate copy of the invoice along with the goods to the transporter.
Okay.
After 1 month, is it possible for us to send one copy of the invoice with QR code? That will suffice the requirement. That's what my query is.
Okay. Ravi?
Sir.
Yeah.
See, the notification clearly says that now the duplicate and triplicate is not at all applicable. So whatever invoice copy you generate, so that can be carried along with you. There is no duplicate, triplicate, and any multiple copies requirement is there.
But so, it's also the QR code.
Along with the QR code, and when the invoice anyway has to accompany the movement of goods. So in those cases, you can present a hard copy with QR code, or a soft copy, which if you can show on a digital device with a QR code, which can be readable by a QR code reader, that will suffice the purpose.
Is that clear?
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. We go to row number 27. For tax invoices generated and goods sent, say, prior to 1st October, but wrongly uploaded in GSTR1 as B2C, will it be possible to amend the same in to B2B in Table 9 of GSTR1 of October 20? See, how are you handling it today? If something has been reported as B2C earlier, and now you are issuing, then you'll issue an invoice on which date? And as I mentioned earlier, the acid test is date of invoice. Reporting of an invoice can be done in the relevant month or any subsequent month of GSTR1. That is not a problem. But it is the important part is, what is the date of invoice which you will be putting it here? Will your ERP allow you to use the same invoice number which you had issued for B2C? For the previous period, my understanding is first the accounting standard doesn't allow it, and ERPs also don't allow it. So necessarily you will have to cancel that first one. I mean, that's the practice I have understood, and issue a new invoice. Now, if there is any gap in my understanding, please clarify. Otherwise, it will depend on the date of invoice which will be issued by changing that supply which was earlier recorded as B2C as B2B.
So
the person who had asked the question, please clarify. Yeah.
I think the question is, because of the cutover from 1st October for a previous transaction, this is something which we have seen in many business situations where a B2C invoice where the buyer originally doesn't give the GST registration number. And subsequently, after finding out that he is not getting the GST invoice, it comes back and gives the GST registration number. So yeah. Subsequently, we amend the GSTR1 to move it from B2C to B2B.
Is it allowed? Is it allowed?
Amendment is allowed, Bishop.
No, but you cannot amend the invoice because that B2C invoice is not reported in GSTR1.
So it will be not reported in B2B table, but elsewhere it would have been reported.
Yeah. So what you will do now, I mean, that is what people are doing, that they report as a new invoice as B2B and make adjustment of that much amount in the subsequent month of B2C. This is what people do, right?
Right.
So that is why I was saying the date of invoice is the acid test. In that case, if you're issuing after 1st of October, a fresh invoice for that transaction,
then it has
to be reported. Yeah. That's, see, we always go, I'm a science student, I always go into the basic, and from there I start.
Right.
Sir, can I clarify it, sir?
Yes, please.
Sir, Mr. Sriram, give you an example where the invoice is without the GSTN number, but there are instances where
There is a valid invoice. They have put the recipient GST number also. The invoice is prepared. It is complete with all the particulars. But when they are uploading it in GSTR1, no, all of us do it only in the last 1 hour. So that time it is wrongly uploaded under the head B2C instead of putting under B2B.
No, sorry. Who is speaking? This?
Yeah, my name is Sarathi here, sir. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, I can hear you. But first, tell me one thing. How can you upload an invoice which is already uploaded in one of the tables, either 4 or 6 of GSTR1, as B2C? No, that is not possible.
No, sir. It is the first time I'm uploading. When I'm uploading...
You are not saying, you should say, not uploading. I have wrongly put it under B2C rather than putting under B2B.
Exactly, sir. Exactly.
Yeah. So you should not say that. See, I know this inside out, how this bloody system operates. So you cannot put a B2B invoice under B2C while you're uploading. Uploading B2C is only a consolidated value. So what you are saying that I forgot, I misclassified a B2B sale as B2C sale. Right?
Exactly. Yes, sir. This is causing a lot of anxiety because the recipient will not be getting 2A.
He'll not get 2A. Then he will come back to you and say that, look, you did not upload my invoice. So please do that. That is what I was asking the earlier gentleman, that how do you handle it? The B2C invoice is not reported in GSTR1, so you cannot go and amend that. Right? Now, if you report that today, because it was actually a valid B2B invoice issued earlier, then it will have that date. Only thing you're reporting in the subsequent month and you'll pay interest on that. Okay? There's no problem on that front. What he was saying, that the person did not have GSTN at that time, so it was given as a B2C. Later, he got with effect from that date. Then how do I handle it? So that's also I had to explain.
Yeah, that you can cancel the invoice. Earlier invoice is an issue of
fresh. No, earlier one is not an invoice. Earlier one is a bill of supply. Because you cannot issue an invoice to an unregistered person. It's a URP. Yeah, yeah.
No, it's clear, sir. It's clear.
Yeah. See, I have also been a tax officer for a long time. So I understand nuances. Okay. This year, owing to demerger, I have obtained a separate GSTN. Can I voluntarily register for e-invoice considering that my business previous turnover was more than? See, it depends. If you have obtained a separate GSTN, but if you are on the same PAN, then you are covered under that definition. Right? So it is at the PAN level, not at the GSTN level. But if you have got a separated company, has become a separate entity, it has got a separate PAN, and on that PAN, if you have a GSTN, then it will be for the new PAN, what is the turnover? I hope I have clarified that.
Right.
Okay, so I'll request my colleague Ravi, now he must have copied by now the subsequent ones, so that he can put it there and we can just go through that.
Okay. Sir, you are able to see, sir?
Yes, the first one is your favorite, so you start.
This tax collected at source, which is collected under income tax by the suppliers. So, this presently there is no separate column to mention this amount. So, you can mention it under other charges invoice level, which don't form part of taxable value. In fact, this answer has come from you only. So, your suggestion is correct. And whether e-invoice is required for non-GST credit notes. See, if you are issuing credit note under GST Act, that is the rules, you kindly report it. So credit notes are covered under e-invoicing. Whether e-invoice is required for plant-to-plant movement of goods. See, this was also asked earlier in the context of that entity question. It was mixed up. See, in GST regime, all the branches, they are individual registrations. So if it is a registered person sale also, it has to be reported. Means branch to branch transfer, that's what you are asking perhaps in different states under same PAN.
So you can clarify a little more, Ravi. If the two plants are in the same state and not registered at separate GSTN, then the plant to plant movement is handled on challan. But if both plants are in the same state and have different GSTN, then it is a supply as considered under GSTN because these are under two different registered
persons.
Absolutely. Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's the way to look at it. Again, go back to basic and look, these plants are whether they are on the same GST or different GST.
Sure.
And during testing in sandbox, we are getting an error as invalid customer GSTIN. However, we when we check the GST portal, the status is active. So, Bhatji, can you kindly throw light on this? Because
I know what it is.
Through the email, we'll check up and get back to you. Send through the email exactly GSTIN ID, yeah, which you are facing a problem. We'll check up and get back to you on that.
Bhatji, are you suppose someone's name is not there in that list of 48,000 plus? If he comes and tries in testing, then what do you give? First, he cannot enter because he is not. He will not be having any.
Okay, sir. Login will not, registration will not be allowed to him because he's not there in the 48,000. But here the question is not clear. Invalid customer.
Is it for the recipient GSTIN? Let's ask.
Yeah.
The person who has written it, can you just confirm
it is for the
whether
recipient
GSTIN? Yeah. Please let us know this GSTIN so that, because what we do, we share at the end of the day basis with e-bill and e-invoice system the new registrations and the cancellations. So this could be one case where it was cancelled in the day, or it was restored the day, and that you had checked an hour or two after that before the information could be shared with NIC system. Please send it to us. We will we'll check and we'll let you know. Sure. Ravi, go ahead.
And the fifth one, presently we are coming out of COVID impact. Can we have an extension for e-invoicing? So the only thing is presently the date October 1st stands. If at all you have any concerns, kindly send to the email ID. We'll convey to the government.
And see, basically, this is a decision which lies with government. We cannot make any commitment or any comment on that.
And sixth one, they are asking auto industry are using OEMs, that original. So can they get IRN on behalf of their dealers? Presently, generating the IRN on behalf of somebody else or on behalf of some other registered persons is allowed only in respect of e-commerce operators. So in the question asked, the answer is no. Then seventh one, how to capture vendor IRN in our ERP? Can we use NIC QR code reader in ERP? So NIC QR code reader is a mobile app. And in that mobile app, you can scan the QR code. And additionally, you can upload the signed JSON or signed QR code, that that string. In fact, QR code, when it is returned to the to your system, it is not an image, but it is a string. So you can upload the entire string into that, and you can verify that also.
No, so her question is, the question is little different. Here, the vendor has uploaded, and the person asking the question is a buyer. This may be one of the large auto companies in Chennai. Now the OEM has uploaded. Now they want to know how to capture the vendor IRN. Now, if you ask them to give you the signed JSON, that's the ideal thing because it will have everything. It will have IRN also. It will have that upload unique number, your date, etc. Because IRN, as you know, it's a long string. On the other hand, the e-invoice system gives you a unique number, acknowledgement number and date, which is smaller, and that can be used for searching, etc. easily. It is not mandatory to print that, but then it comes along with a payload. So if you get the entire, this is just an advice as an IT person to you.
Okay.
That if you take it, then you can use it, you can pass the JSON, and after that, whichever item you want, you can use it and take it in your ERP. Also talk to your ERP, because all ERPs, we have asked them that once this load comes to them, when the person is buyer, how does he read and take into his ERP? That's also a very important functionality, because the main purpose is to avoid any data entry. So once, if I get that payload, signed payload, it does two things. One, you are sure that whatever he has reported to IRP and which will go to GSTR1 has come to you. So there is no tampering in that. Number two, your ERP should be able to read and digest that data and populate your purchase register against that PO which you have issued. So this capability we have requested all ERPs also to create. Please ask your ERP so that this is done. I hope I am clear.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and just to add, on e-invoice portal, there is a link called verify signed invoice, signed e-invoice. So you can use that link, and whatever is the invoice JSON sent by the supplier, you can just upload it and verify it.
So Ravi, here, this person must be either from Hyundai or TVS who receive thousands of invoices. It is not no mechanic, I mean, no human or other.
Yes, sir.
It has to be automated process. And that is what our intent is, that the moment my supplier or OEM sends me, my system should check following whether digital signature is intact. Then I should be able to open that payload and take into my purchase register. And yes, then thereafter, ERP should do something else as well, that I had ordered for 100 pieces. How many pieces have come in this particular invoice? All those things, anyway, they do it. I'm just giving some extra information, but that should be. So please talk to your ERP or billing service or your own IT team to do like that, so that you not only get IRN, but acknowledgement number, etc. And the most important part is it should get assimilated in your system. There is no need for data entry. So that is what it is. Yes.
Absolutely.
Please go ahead.
Sir, on the last question, this cancellation window, presently it is within 24 hours. And even, see, there is one more finer point here. Some people are asking, within 24 hours, we will cancel it and we will report an invoice with same invoice number. That is also not possible.
Yes.
So once reported with the invoice number, that is the end of it. If you cancel it, you have to report another invoice with another invoice number to generate another fresh IRN. And here, this question is slightly unclear. If so, that credit note has to be accepted by counterparty as per law, which will create issue to the supplier. Extend cancellation of IRN within the same month.
No, you please read the second line. It says, under e-invoice, if it crosses 24 hours, do we need to raise credit note and square that transaction? See, again, I mean, we should not get into the basic, where do you need to issue a credit note and how. This is your tax people will tell you.
Right.
Simple thing is cancellation. If my buyer tells, okay, you don't need to send it and I need to cancel it. I've already reported that invoice and it is, IRN has been generated. So as Ravi said, you just cancel that.
That's all. Okay,
that was the last question that we had. If there is anything, we have already completed 2 hours. And,
sir,
I will suggest, Mr. Sriram, if there are further questions, you can just compile them and
send
it to on that email ID which we had given.
Definitely.
And Mr. Kennedy, we tried our law knowledge also. I hope we were on the right track.
Certainly, it was much better, actually.
It was really nice.
Okay. No, Ravi is a IRS tax officer. I mean, in fact, he is one of our subject matter experts inside the company. But because we are more from the technology side. I've been appellate authority for a long time. So I understand tax nuances and how the whole thing has been done here. So if there is no further question, I would like to thank Siddhi and Mr. Kennedy for giving us this opportunity here. Or to us, meaning to Mr. Bhatt, Ravi, Pankaj, and me, to present, clarify your doubts. We hope we have been able to answer most of your queries. If there's anything left, please send it through Mr. Sriram. And we will, what we do, like today also we got some new questions.
Right.
We'll add that into the FAQ. So our FAQ is started with some 40. It has already crossed 90. Very soon it will cross 100. But the idea is that we should keep on adding so that all kinds of questions are answered.
So only question
is the FAQ. It's very useful, sir.
So only request is FAQs can be serial numbered, sir, so that we know which is the latest one.
Yeah, sure. We will version it next time. We will version it with the date. so that you are clear that which one is
there. Other thing also you can do, Ravi, we can all the new ones now added on such and such date, so that people know that this has been newly added one. We'll do that.
Yes.
So really thank you, Mr. Prakash Kumar, Mr. James Kennedy, for staying all through the session. Mr. Ravi, Mr. Bhatt, all the GSTN and NIC official. I would like to thank, and of course, we will definitely come back to you, sir, with all our documentation related question, which you wanted us to give with an example. We produce documents as well as example, so that you can clarify as part of your FAQ those questions.
Yeah, you can send the sample invoice copies if possible, so that how the items are mentioned.
We will do that, sir. So with that, I would like to formally conclude the session with a vote of thanks. On behalf of Southern India Chamber of Commerce and on behalf of the President of Southern India Chamber of Commerce, I would like to thank the Commissioner for gracing the occasion and sharing his thoughts. Again, I would like to thank Mr. Prakash Kumar. I'm sure he must have been doing this in several occasions, in several webinars. Quite patiently he has been handling all the questions and have been explaining. And every day as we move forward in the next 10 days, I'm sure there are a lot more questions and a lot more answers, which will add and enrich to the whole e-invoicing regime. So thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Bhatt. Thank you, Mr. Ravi Kumar. You have taken your time out of the busy schedule and agreeing to address the members of the Southern India Chamber. I'm sure all of you would agree that the session is very timely and at this critical juncture has provided much clarity on several issues and to help prepare the companies to go live from 1st October 2020. There are and there will be several other questions that may warrant clarification, and the Chamber would take up the same with the concern and provide the responses. And I would like to thank the participants who have participated in large numbers and made the program a success. Finally, I'd like to thank the Secretariat of SICKY for making all the arrangements and making this event a success. So thank you once again, all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.